to make a brief announcement before Mass starts. My name is Helena Clare, for those of you who don't know me, and I, along with Lori Walsh, our co-chair of the Social Activities Committee, which is getting back into action after a long hiatus. I'm here today to fill you in on our upcoming parish picnic in just 2 weeks on Sunday, September 11th, at noon across the street, noon till 4, across the street at the Midway Firehouse Grove. The cost is only $10 per person for a total of $40 per family. Okay? Tickets are on sale this weekend and next weekend in the gym. We'll be right there after Mass. We hope you can join us for the fun, the good food, the games, and the 50-50 raffle. Now, the parish will provide sub sandwiches and drinks, but the delicious side dishes and the desserts, they have to come from us, from parishioners. Hence my reason for being up here. Any event like this relies on volunteers for the side dishes, for the games, for help in general. So in order to get back to bringing you the fun activities you have enjoyed in the past, the Social Activities Committee needs volunteers, folks that are willing to share ideas for future activities and help out now and then. We're not looking for long-term commitment, just a little bit of your time and a lot of your ideas. You can even join us to share ideas and get things going and then decide that you'd only like to help on a specific event. That would be great too. So keep watching the bulletin for more information about a formative meeting. Okay, now back to the picnic. In order to have everything we need to make it a success, we have to have an idea of how many to prepare for and who might be bringing what. The flyer in the bulletin has suggestions for donated dishes based on the first letter and last names. But we do know that many of you have a specialty you'd like to prepare and share, and we welcome that too. Finally, Lori and I will be in the gym after Mass to sell tickets, again only $10 each, maximum $40 per family, and take names for donated foods or just to answer questions about joining our ministry. And please give the volunteer things some thought. Remember, the more helpers, the less any one person has to do. Thank you for your time.
Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the Church of St. Paul. Before we begin Mass today, let us take a few moments to place ourselves in the presence of God as we observe a moment of silence. Now please stand. Our opening song is Gather Up.
Thank you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
O Lord, you are good and forgiving, full of mercy to all who call to you. O Lord, give us.
Everyone who exalts oneself will be humbled. The one who humbles oneself will be exalted. These words of Jesus indicate that to be truly humble, we must know who and what we are. For humility is truth and demands that we give up the vain struggle to be who we are not.
Sisters and brothers, to prepare ourselves for the banquet of the Lord, in humility, we truthfully acknowledge our sins before God, the judge of all.
Lord Jesus, model of humility, you exalt all who humble themselves in your presence. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you are meek and humble of heart. Draw us to yourself. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, when we tend to exaggerate our importance and minimize others, fill us with humility. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us. Forgive us our sins and trouble, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Not for a place of honor did your Son call us, O God of glory, but to invite to the wedding feast the poor, the lame, and the blind. Let such humility grace our table and lead us to renounce the quest for power and privilege. Taking our place with other sinners, may we share the sacrificial banquet your Son has prepared for those who place their trust in your grace alone. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, and lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
I do you, O Lord, and I do.
But rather, when you hold a banquet, Invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind, all those who cannot repay. Blessed indeed will you be because of their inability to repay you, for you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
So you're searching for your table, and you finally find it, and it's at the farthest point away from the head table. In fact, you're right by the band. And even worse, you're right in front of one of those huge amplifiers, those huge speakers. Have you ever been there? I have. Yes, you're absolutely right. How do we feel in a situation like that? Slighted, perplexed, hurt, or maybe you just want to be in the background? Would you feel any better if you were seated near the head table? Where we sit is important to us, isn't it? Especially in church. Our seat. And Lord forbid anyone should sit in our seat. Our seats are important to us, whether it's at church or at home or at work, because at work our seat may indicate our status. And our seats say a lot about who we are, or at least who we think we are. We spend a great deal of time worrying about our seats, arranging our seats, protecting our seats. And at first glance, we might think that this gospel from Luke is about seating arrangements. Where's Jesus sitting in this story? We don't know. But we do know he is at the house of the leading Pharisee. And he may be sitting near the head table, or they reclined the table. You know, everyone was reclining the table. Some were further away from the center and others were not. But maybe Jesus was near the Pharisee, but maybe he was near the back door too. Do you think he cared? Probably not. But his point is that in the kingdom of God, seating arrangements are not important. Everyone is equal. It's like when we gather for liturgy, we pass through these doors, we're all equal. It doesn't matter who we are or who we think we are out in the world, but we're all equal as children of God here. And Jesus is reminding us that in the light of eternity, our human status, our power, our prestige, our possessions, in the kingdom of God, in the light of eternity, they mean nothing. Nothing. What is important, Jesus says, is the depth with which we have loved the Lord and loved one another, regardless of who they are or where they sit. And both Jesus and the author of the book of Sirach, which was our first reading, teach us to conduct ourselves with humility. And that doesn't mean being a doormat, but rather Jesus is calling us and teaching us that we are called as those who are gifted, we're enriched, and we're nourished by God. That's one of the reasons we're here now, to be nourished by Jesus Christ. And it doesn't stop there, because then we are to go out and to nourish others in the same way. And as Christians, we try our best to share the gift of life that we have, not not so that we can stand out, but so that others may be able to stand with us, especially the poor, and celebrate the God who has blessed us. Not so much that we can stand out, but that others can stand with us. And yet, in our culture, aren't we constantly reminded that our worth, our status, is how powerful we are, how much influence we have, how well-regarded we are, how wealthy we are, how comfortably we might live. And we strive to enter this wide gate of success. Remember the narrow? Strive to enter through the narrow gate that we heard recently in the gospel? Well, I think that in the world, there's a wide gate of success that we're trying to enter. It beckons us, often to the detriment of others. Mother Teresa was once asked, so how do you measure the success of all you do? And she thought, she said, well, I don't remember that the Lord ever spoke about success. He only spoke of faithfulness and love. And that's the only real success that counts. Let me just sum this up with a story. It was a story about a group of graduates who went back to a college reunion, and they decided they'd go and speak with one of their old professors. And so, as inevitably happens, the conversation turned to complaints about the stress in their lives. And so the professor went into the kitchen and returned with a large pot of hot chocolate and an assortment of cups. And some of the cups were plain looking, and some were expensive, some were exquisite. And he said, just help yourselves to the hot chocolate. And so they went and retrieved the cups, and they did. And when they all had a cup in hand, the professor said to them, notice that all the nice-looking, expensive cups were taken, but you left behind all the plain and cheap ones. And while it's normal to want only the best for yourselves and ourselves, he said, that's the source of your problems, your stress and your anxiety. He said, the cup that you're drinking from adds nothing to the quality of that hot chocolate. And in most cases, the cup's just more expensive than in some cases even hides the flavor of the hot chocolate. He said, what you really wanted was the hot chocolate, not the cup, but you consciously went for the best. And then, he said, you began eyeing each other's cups. Probably part of our human condition. Now, he said, consider this. Life is the hot chocolate. Your job, your money, your position in society are the cups. They're just tools to hold our lives. He said, the cup does not define you at all, nor change the quality of your life. But he said, sometimes by concentrating on that cup and on that cup only, we fail to enjoy the hot chocolate that God has provided to us. God makes the hot chocolate. We choose the cups. The happiest people don't have the best of everything. They just make the best of everything they have. And so, as we go forth, let us live simply, love generously, care deeply, speak kindly, and enjoy our hot chocolate. And it doesn't matter if you sit near the band. You may even get to speak with the guy who plays the guitar.
Professing the same creed that is preached in the whole missions, the Apostles' Creed together. I believe in God,
our Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, and Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit.
We invite our response, Lord, hear our prayer. We pray this day for God's church, the people of God, that we may recognize the many ways that God is present and active in our lives. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray this day for all in authority, that they may follow in the footsteps of Christ in being servants to others as true servant leaders, attentive to those in the most need. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
O Lord, we pray this day for the protection of your good earth. May you guide us in being good stewards of your creation, so that all people may experience the blessings that the earth brings forth. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for all recovering from natural disasters, that the Lord will give them strength and patience and speed the resources they need to recover. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for the success of today's second collection for the Catholic Home Missions, that through our generosity we continue to support the missionary activities and strengthen the Catholic Church in the United States. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
O Lord, we pray for all of our sisters and brothers who have been reborn into the baptism of eternal life. We especially remember at this Mass Bess Resides, who died recently, and for James Beninati Sr., Angie Hayes, Edward Walsh, and William and Christina McDonald. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for all of the intentions in the parish petition box and in our parish book of intentions, as well as for all of those intentions that reside within the silence of our hearts. O Lord, may you find them pleasing in your sight. We pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Loving God, send your Spirit to guide us as we proclaim your message throughout our nation. Bless our efforts to reach out in home mission dioceses where faith is strong but resources are few. Encourage all those who work to strengthen your church and those who receive that strength, so that all in the United States will hear your call to faithful discipleship through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And the second collection is for the home missions.
Thank you.
place which is among us. And then I offer our gifts with humility and mindful gratitude. Sins alone cannot keep us from offering to you the giver of gifts. May they be accepted to God the Almighty. sooner or later, taking the chalice and blessing filled with the fruit of life, Jesus gave thanks, gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and drink from it. This is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, to be poured out for you and for the many, for the forgiveness of sins. Then he said to him, do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith.
Deliver us, O Lord, from every evil, especially trial
strengthen and deepen my relationship with you as I seek to encounter and serve you, not only in prayer, but all I need to, especially in the poor and deep and profound need. And may the mighty blood of our Lord Jesus Christ for all of us.
Thank you.
being the food of charity, it may confirm our hearts and stir us to serve you and our neighbor through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
As you may recall, over the last few weeks, we have put bulletin inserts in the bulletin talking about new members of the pastoral council and seeking people to enter into a discernment process. Well, we had seven people enter into the discernment process last Wednesday evening, and under the guidance of the Holy Spirit and prayer, I'm happy to report that we have three new members of our pastoral council, Maria Conlon, Pam Dance, and Ann Green. So we're going to have the pictures taken, and we're really going to increase the visibility of the pastoral council as we go forth in forming our strategic pastoral plan for our church. Also, we're always in need of people to help out, and we are in a real high need for people to help out at Mass by being, we're calling them ambassadors. We used to call them ushers, but nobody really knows how to usher means. So we're calling them ambassadors. We go to St. Paul, ambassadors work for Christ. So we need all your servers and ambassadors just to pick up the collection. And we also need readers. So please consider using your gifts in this area. Our liturgy. And lastly, we've been talking about electronic giving, and we have a little contest going on. Electronic giving is one of the ways that we're trying to increase our offertory. We're going to be talking about that over the next few months, because we really need to pay attention to that. But we have a contest and the drawing for all those who signed up for electronic giving. Going to be held tomorrow after the 9:30 Mass, so you don't need to be present to win, but we're really excited to give out some nice prizes that we're donating to the parish. Thank you.
Speaking of giving, I'm calling attention to a very kind letter in bulletin from Sister Claire Hannah, missionary sister that was with us a couple of weeks ago. It was a very beautiful letter of gratitude. And we will be on time for the 5:44 post time for the travelers. May God the Father, who is invited us to his heavenly kingdom, strengthen.